for being with us. Peter and Tina, how are you? Good to see you guys. Praying for you this afternoon. Great day ahead of us. Amen. To all of our friends watching us from around the world. It's crazy. Some of our media team was showing me this week. We got folks from all over the globe that tune in to watch our services either live or during the week. It's just crazy. So we're going to have to brush up on some languages around here. Amen. Bonjour. Comment allez-vous? That's all I know how to say in French, y'all. So stop right there. Good to be in the house of the Lord with you guys. How many of you were here last Wednesday night for summer nights? A bunch of us were here. We had some cracking food. We had some great fellowship time. Pastor Keys brought a great word. And, you know, we can't be haters up in here. I know we got Raider fans, but we can't be haters in the house of the Lord here in San Francisco. But we talked about blessing even those who are our enemies. Amen. Not just forgiving them, but blessing them. And that wasn't easy to do. It's never easy to do, but that was a great word. Pastor Keys, do we have a theme for this next Wednesday night already? We're staying in the same kind of, you know, things that I wish Jesus had never said theme, all right? So come back Wednesday night, 6:30. We have free food for those of you who want to come and just grab a little bite to eat, a pick-me-up during the middle of the week, if you will. And, you know, then we have some songs that we sing together, and it's just chill. It's just relaxed. Lauren from South Africa and Stefan have been with us for the last 2 weeks. Lauren had a popping word. And thank you for being ready in season. This is the way we get down here in the city. We love hanging out with the church family, and it's a great opportunity to just be built up spiritually, but even in the natural as well. Amen. Also, last Sunday, we talked about one of our core values in the series of non-negotiables. We talked about missions for us is not just an accessory. It's embedded in who we are. I'm an MK, not 47, but I'm a missionary kid. And I grew up on the mission field, like Meadow going to Alaska on a missions trip this summer. I love missions, and it's part of who I am. It's part of our church DNA. And we've sent teams and leaders around the globe. And along with that, we put our money where our mouth is. We've sown hundreds of thousands of dollars now, even as a young baby church. Come on, for the glory of God. We boast in the Lord. Amen. We don't just talk about it. We're going to be about it. And so I want to, again, celebrate the opportunity that we have today. Strategically, we prayed, and today we have the privilege of having some friends come who are going to come and share the word of God. And you're going to fall in love with these folks right here. And we've felt the connection from the Holy Spirit to partner with them because they've stepped out of the boat into the water, if you will. And they're about ready to plant a church in Phoenix, Arizona. Anybody feel a missions trip coming up real soon to Phoenix, Arizona? Go help out some folks. And Pastor Mark, I've known him now for several years from Stockton, California. He and Robin, their daughter Christiana, they were sent out just a few months back, and they're going to be launching in September a brand new church, and he'll tell you about it a little bit more. But what we're going to do today, we're going to be blessed by a tremendous word, but I want to pull out the China today. You know, like when you got guests over to the house, it's like you cram everything into the closets, all the dirty laundry, pretend like everything's clean. And then it's like you bring out the best dishware, whatever. It's like, man. And what we're going to do, if you're a guest, don't feel, this is not a timeshare presentation, don't feel pressured by this at all. But as a church family, we've been talking about it, we've been praying. But I want us to give a huge offering at the end of our service today to bless this ministry. We're going to write a check. It's going to be a huge check. Together we're better. Amen. You might think, I don't have a whole lot to contribute. Give something. Sow something. And the beauty about this offering is that there is an organization, a church planting organization, that will match every dollar that we give. I don't know about you, man. That means if you gave whatever, $25, they just double that right there. So whatever it is that God begins to speak to you about, and by the time they leave town to go back to Phoenix, we're going to be adding on to whatever the Lord's already been blessing them with. And we want to represent. Come on, City Life Church. I told you before, we do one special offering a year. I've been to churches the way they do like three or four offerings. The organist starts playing, and they pass out more buckets or the offering plates, and they meet our budget. Let's do another offering. We don't do that. That's just not the way we flow. But we do one annual offering, and some of the guests just right now, they just cringe. Dang it, I knew them Christian churches, they always try to squeeze money out of people. We don't. I'm just saying today is a special celebration. we have the privilege to partner with a wonderful ministry. So just be praying about that as the Lord will put that on your heart throughout the day. And then at the end of the service, we'll be praying. I'm going to invite leaders to come and lay hands on them, prophesy whatever it is that the Lord has. But it's going to be tremendous. So it is my privilege to introduce a good friend of mine who I've known for several years now. His dad is a theologian, a smart cat, but the son isn't too shabby as well. I mean, he's brilliant, phenomenal communicator. Robin is a phenomenal worship leader herself. The family is anointed. And I won't tell you about what's going on in Colorado. I'll let you share some of that. But it is my privilege to have my friend, Pastor Mark Seagrace, come and preach the word. Would you stand to your feet and welcome the man of God as he comes to bring the word?
Wow. Thank you so much. I told Pastor Jonathan, man, I don't even know if I'm cool enough to preach here. This is all right. I'm going to bring my wife and my baby girl up here just for a second. This is my wife, Robin. And we've been married in November this year. We will have been married 24 years. That's right. Got married when we were 12. And this is my baby right here, Christiana. And so we went on this adventure together. I love going out in public with these guys because people look at them and then they look at me. They're like, "How'd that guy get them?" They think I'm rich. It's really not the case, but that's how we roll. So anyway, these are my babies. So welcome them. Yeah. But wow, just excited to be in the house today and be able to worship with you guys. This worship team is awesome, and man, just ushered in the presence of God, and just love the freedom that I feel in here. Only we're in here just for a few minutes, man. People walking up to me, giving me a good word from God, and all of that. And so yeah, just love you guys already. Got to come tour the place kind of earlier on, but this is our first chance to be in service with you. So we're really excited. Love your pastors. Pastor Jonathan and Elena, man, they have just been great friends. He is my hero, man. Awesome church planner, man of God, powerful man of God. And so, when I went to get my haircut Thursday, I was right there, man. I was like, just I want that anointing, you know. So I'm like, just take it, all. But man, she got real close with that razor, man. I just couldn't do it, and so I stopped a little short. So I'm not really to his level yet. But it seems like all successful church planters have a really cool haircut and wear skinny jeans. So I'm thinking I could do the haircut. Yeah. The other ain't happening right now. So. I feel like I've got a word for us this morning that I want to share with you, and also it's an excuse to include part of our story. I think I drank all my water. Do I got another one? Man, you guys, look at that. They even took the lid off. That's what I'm talking about, details. Man, somebody from City Life put together an awesome just gift basket for my wife and I and Christiana. Man, it had like Ghirardelli chocolate in it. It had like Nutella that you dip in stuff, and we weren't even dipping it. We just, you know, so man, we were just enjoying that, and that's why I didn't wear my skinny jeans today, right there. But anyway, so I want to begin by pointing your attention to the prophet Isaiah, chapter 43. Just read a few verses here to begin, and then we'll get right into this. So Isaiah 43 and verse 16 says, "Thus says the Lord, who makes a way in the sea and a path through mighty waters." He's retelling the story here about Israel and how they were brought miraculously out of the land of Egypt when they had been in slavery. So you might recognize that imagery there, that he is making a way in the sea, that Red Sea that parted, a path through the mighty waters. And then he says, "Who brings forth the chariot and horse, the army and the power. And they shall lie down together, they shall not rise, they are extinguished, they are quenched like the wick of a candle. So if you remember this story, there was a big famine in the land, and there were slaves. These people who had gone to Egypt to be miraculously saved from this famine because there was provision in Egypt, they ended up as slaves in the land of Egypt for 400 years, and they cried out for deliverance. And I don't know why it took them 400 years to cry out for deliverance, because I'm pretty much crying out in the first 5 minutes. Men don't tolerate pain very much. You know what I'm talking about. You women know what I'm talking about. We don't tolerate pain. But they waited 400 years, and then they cried out for deliverance in such a way that God heard their cry, because God hears us when we cry, right? And he brings them out miraculously. I'm not preaching about this morning, so I'm just going to hurry through this. And so as they're coming out of Egypt, God, they come to the waters of the Red Sea, and they've got mountains on the left and mountains on the right. And now there's an army, there's an enemy from Egypt that's coming after them, and there's nowhere to go. And so God parts the waters of the Red Sea, and they're able to walk through on dry ground. But then the enemy follows them across. And so as the enemy kind of gets out there in the middle, the people of Israel look back from their safe place, and God brings the water back together again and destroys the enemy, because God doesn't want to just bring you out. He wants to also destroy the influence of the enemy in your life. Man, that sounds fun this morning, but I'm not even preaching on that. But here's what's so amazing to me is that God is big on remembering what he has done. It's awesome to remember the miracles and the signs and the wonders that have happened in our life, where God has stepped in and he has superseded the natural and the normal, and he has done something supernatural and abnormal in our life. So that's why this is so interesting, that when you get down to this next verse, here he is reminding them about the awesome things that he has done and bringing them out of the land of Egypt. But then in verse 18, he says, "Do not remember the former things, nor consider the things of old." He says, as awesome as all of that was, for me to bring you out of Egypt, for me to destroy the armies of Egypt in the Red Sea, I don't want you to think so much about that. I don't want you to focus so much on that. Don't get stuck on that, because verse 19, "Behold, I will do a new thing." A new thing. "Now it shall spring forth. Shall you not know it? I will even make a road in the wilderness and rivers in the desert." Pick somebody good looking next to you and just tell them God is getting ready to do something new. Now you can apologize to the other person that you didn't think was good looking enough to tell them that. Tell them that. Say, God is getting ready to do something new. Yeah, so I'll tell you a little bit of our story. So our family has experienced a lot of change in just the last couple of years, crazy stuff. Our son, Luke, who's not with us today, of course, he graduated from high school. That was crazy. Yeah, believe me. Whoop, whoop. Yeah, we're like ready for that. He graduates from high school. He joins the military, runs off to boot camp. Man, he wants to be like, you know, like whatever, yeah, G.I. Joe with a kung fu grip kind of guy. And now he's driving a jet-fueled Striker tank. He can barely drive a car. I won't let him drive my car. He's driving a tank. So he has he goes to boot camp at a certain season of the year that he gets to. They let him off for Christmas. I didn't even know they did that. But they gave him 17 days off from boot camp for Christmas. He comes home and he says, "I'm ready to get married. I got 2 weeks." And so Mama and I got busy, and we threw together something in a couple of weeks, and he married this awesome young lady that he'd been dating for a while, and so that was about a year and a half ago, and right here, right up in this house while I'm preaching this word, that lady is in the hospital in Colorado, and she's about to make me a grandpa for the first time. Can you believe that? I know when you see this, you're like, you ain't ready for grandpa, man. You got to go. Right. No, I got nothing, man. So then to top that off, my baby girl over here, Christiana, beautiful, gorgeous, awesome, man. She turned 16, and that's killing me. So I do want to point out that she is single. But I am very familiar with shotguns. And her brother is qualified as a sniper. I'm just saying right there. So, but you know what I'm talking about. Change is going on in your life, right? So I mean, literally, I don't do change very well. I mean, I like it when things are just rolling along, and I'm not into change. And so that's why for 17 years since my baby girl was born, actually just a few months before my baby girl was born, I got a pair of glasses. And I wore that pair of glasses until 2 weeks ago. 17 years. I couldn't see. I'm walking around. I don't know how to drive. My eyes have changed. I've gotten old. The prescription's wrong. But I am not changing those glasses. I was hoping, yeah, you keep them on another 20 years, the style comes back, right? So, but finally, 2 weeks ago, I realized I needed to see a little bit more clearly. So I went and now look, I mean, come on, somebody. I am throwing down on some new glasses. So now where I was old-fashioned before, now I'm trendy and now I'm edgy. I like to say I'm on fleek a little bit. Come on. My daughter can't believe I know that word right there. Yeah. But, so I don't do change very well. I got a problem with change in some ways. But I have to tell you that if God is in the change, then I'm in. Then bring it on, right? I'm ready for the change if God's in it. So we've gone through that in the last couple of years. And Robin and I, we've been married, like I said, almost 24 years. We've been involved in every kind of ministry that you can think of since that time. I mean, we've done the scrubbing the toilets thing and the youth pastor thing, and which is pretty much the same thing at times, yeah. Pastor Jonathan, when I was a youth pastor, I signed a 6-page contract for all of the responsibilities of the youth pastor. And I should never have signed the contract, because the last line of the contract said, "And anything else the pastor asks you to do." It's like, so he actually asked me to pave the parking lot by myself. I mean, he said, "I want you to get the squeegee out there and the oil." Yeah, go out there. Yeah, it didn't happen. But anyway, So Rob and I, we've done everything, man. We've done the worship pastor and the associate pastor, the executive pastor, the lead pastor, all that kind of stuff. And so the last 6 years, we've been over in Stockton at LifeSong, and just one of the most amazing seasons of ministry in our life for 6 years. One of our best friends pastored over there. Pastor Jonathan goes over there and ministers quite regularly, and man, it was just awesome. Robin and I really were feeling 7 years ago that God was calling us to plant a church, and in the middle of that, James calls me, and he says, "Man, we just merged together. We became LifeSong. It's a brand new church, and our church has grown, and I need help and want you to come over here and be a part of this." So we decided to go share that with them. And so we went over there, and man, it was crazy. I think when we got there, you know, the church was averaging like 250 people, and it was making a difference in the community. But 5 years later, in fact, last year for Easter, they had almost 1,600. And so it was just like growing like crazy. So I'm thinking, this is good. This is where I'm at. This is what God's called me to do. I'm right in the middle of the will of God. And we're, in fact, we were planning retirement. We're thinking 25 years from now, man, we are set. We're good to go. And right in the middle of all of this good stuff, Robin and I both started feeling like, you know, God was or something was happening. I didn't even know she was feeling this. I was feeling something on my own. And so she's over there by herself feeling like God's talking to her. And I'm feeling like I'm going through a midlife crisis. So I'm shopping for Harley Davidsons and leather jackets. And I'm telling you, you don't want to see this in leather. I'm just saying right now. So, but finally we got together and realized we were both feeling something. And so we got to talk, and we said, you know, I don't know what this is, God, maybe it's God doing something, but you know, if it's just us, if it's just our flesh, then we're going to work through this season and we'll get past that and all of that. But if it's God, it's going to stay with us. And so, then we made the turn of the year last year, and we were focused at LifeSong on doubling at Easter, man. We wanted to just double our influence, double our impact, and et cetera. And we got caught up in that, and it was awesome. Easter was awesome. So I'm thinking we come out of that, and I'm like, man, we're ready to go, going to the next level. And all of a sudden, my wife and I start feeling this again, that God, and now it's getting clear. Now we feel like God's calling us to plant a church. And so we had thought for about 15 years about Phoenix. We're like, someday we might be there. But as we're thinking about this, we started trying to pray about it and isolate, you know, where's God calling us to go, if this is really what he's saying to us, because, man, we were both feeling it. I'm going to do a new thing. And so we're feeling that. And so we got a little bit of clarity, and And so I try to shorten the story down just a little bit, but we're getting ready to take a trip out to Colorado last June, and God had really spoken to us and said, look, Phoenix is the place. That's where I want you to go. So all of a sudden, as we're getting ready to take this trip out to Colorado, I get this message, this random message on Facebook from a family that's actually in Colorado, and I don't really know them, haven't seen them for decades and all of this stuff, and she sends me this message on Facebook, and she says, listen, my son and his wife have moved to Phoenix, and they're there, and we just bought a house there, and we're going to go to Florida and pick up my daughter and her husband and move them out to Phoenix, and then we're going to move to Phoenix, and you know what? If you just come plant a church there, we'd help you do that. And I'm like, how does that happen? I mean, nobody knows what Robin and I are thinking, right? So we go on our trip, and we make it to Colorado, and then we're swinging down towards Southern California to meet some of our staff over there for a conference. And so we had to go through Phoenix and stopped in to visit some people. We stayed the night, Monday night, Tuesday morning, got up to have breakfast, and had breakfast with several families that we know. And we walk in the door, and we're doing the thing. You know, man, it's so good to see you guys. It's been forever. Have you lost weight? Yeah. And, you know, that kind of thing. And when we got done with the greetings, literally two of the families looked at us and they said, man, if you guys would just move to Phoenix and plant a church, we would help you do that. I'm like, man, God, you don't have to hit me upside the head here, right? And so Robin and I are just, we're feeling that God is in this thing. And so we start making our plans. We start thinking about that. And really, the way we're thinking about it, if you read in the book of Acts, the Apostle Paul was trying to find direction for his life, and he goes one direction, and the door gets slammed in his face. He goes another direction, the door slams. So he lays down, and he takes a nap, which is an awesome way to get a word from God. Somebody said amen, right? And so he gets a vision while he's sleeping of a man from Macedonia that says, come over here and help us. And so we felt like that was the word. Like even if none of these families wanted to help us, it was like God is just saying, come on down here. This is where I'm calling you. And so we had all those confirmations. And then we went back to Stockton, and we had a house there, and we decided to put that thing up for sale. We did a little remodel, and we said, all right, if this is God's will, this thing is going to sell like this. Because if you guys know anything about Stockton, a few years ago, foreclosure capital of the world, houses on my street have been for sale for over a year. We put our house for sale on Wednesday night at 6 o'clock. On Thursday morning at 10 o'clock in the morning, the real estate agent calls and says, I want to show your house at noon. And so we're like, well, okay, you know, I mean, that's fast, but let's do this thing. And so we were a little late leaving the house, and I had told my wife, I said, listen, somebody's going to buy this house because they either know us or because they're going to walk in and they're going to feel Holy Spirit going on, right? And so it's going to happen. And so Robin actually walked outside before I did, and I hear her go outside the house, and she says, no way. And she just starts talking, and I walk outside, and standing there is a pastor and his wife that we've known for 30 years. They didn't know it was our house. We didn't know it was them. They said when they saw the pictures go online, they said, God has given us this house. Literally 18 hours, they offered, we countered, they accepted. It was done in 18 hours. Man. So I'm hurrying now. So our church, and Life Song in Stockton, man, they were so gracious. They Pastor James has got a heart to plant churches, and so that's a blessing. And it was hard to leave, man. They cried, we cried, you know, a lot. You know, we did all that, but we knew God was in that, and so we felt like, man, we had favor, we had God with us, and God was speaking to us. Don't remember the former things, man. That was awesome. It was an incredible season. I did some amazing things, but don't consider the things of, oh, behold, I'm going to do a new thing in your life. And so we make our way down there. Now, I got to tell you this story because this is just so awesome. So we go down there, and we moved on a Sunday. We took a big yellow Penske moving truck down there. And on Sunday, Monday morning, I get up and I drive the yellow Penske truck over to a U-Haul place. Penske going to the U-Haul, and they had a storage place. We were going to have to leave for a month. We had to go back to Alabama, do some church planters training and all that stuff, and visit some family. So we're going to be gone for about a month. So I walk into the office of the U-Haul, and the guy's sitting there, the manager's sitting there, and introduces himself. Hey, I'm Sean. Nice to meet you, man. What are you doing moving here? So I start telling him a little bit of the story. Well, we're here to plant a church. It's the first guy I met in Phoenix. He says, tell me what you're doing. You know, so we're planting a church, and this is what's going to look like. He starts asking me questions. Nice businessman, I'm thinking. You know, that's he's just being a nice guy. And I'm trying to get the vision out, man. I'm trying to share what God is doing in us and what kind of church we're going to plant. He interrupts me, And he says, I'm going to give you your rent for free. And I'm like, all right, God. I receive. I'm a church planner, man. I receive, right? So, I don't know why the guy would want to do that. And so I start arguing with him because I didn't realize it was the favor of God. I said, no, you don't understand. I didn't bring a U-Haul truck. Sometimes they give, you know, U-Haul truck, you get a month free at the U-Haul place. But I drove in a Penske truck, so you can't give me the rent for free. He says, no, I'm giving you your rent for free. I said, no, you don't understand. I'm only going to be gone a month. If you don't charge me for this, I'm going to come back, take my stuff out, and you're not going to get any money from me ever. And he says, no, I am giving you your rent for free. And when you start that church, I'm going to be there. I'm like, what was that? First person I met, right? All right, so I'm going to jump ahead a little bit. So we leave on our trip. We go back there. And what's amazing is people started finding. I mean, we're literally parachuting in. Don't really know anybody that we know would want to be a part of our church. So we're parachuting in. And while we're gone back to the East Coast, some people started finding our website. They started finding our Facebook page. One family, they're just looking for a church in our area. They used Google, and they had thousands of churches coming up. So they got on Facebook looking for a church. It came across ours. Doesn't even exist yet. And they're like calling me. You know, they find my number. They call me. And I'm back in Missouri at this point, and they're just, man, we want to be a part of something. We want to serve. We want to do something big here. And so I gave them the answer. Well, you know, when I get back there, we'll meet with you, and that's awesome. And so that was really cool. But then I got a Facebook message from a woman, and she says, man, I just saw what you were doing on Facebook. I don't know, you know, really know you guys, but man, it sounds like something we'd be interested in. We'd like to serve and be a part of a church. And so I call her back, you know, or message her back, and say, listen, that'd be great when we get to Phoenix. I mean, it seems like people are coming together to form this church before I can even get there, right? So I messaged her back, and I said, the same thing. When I get to Phoenix, we'll meet you. We'll have dinner. We'll talk about it and everything. So about a week later, she messages me on Facebook again, and she says, I got to be honest with you. I'm like, uh-oh. She says, actually, she goes, my husband and I, we've been in church. She says, I'm actually a pastor's daughter. She says, but we've been far from God for a long time. She says, and I'm just looking for a place so that I can come home. I'm like, come on, Jesus. People far from God are already seeking it out so they can be a part of it. So God's just doing stuff. So I'll come back to that later. So we come back to Phoenix. I got to share this with you. We come back to Phoenix. I'll get past my story in a minute and start preaching for a second. So the foundation's really big. The building's going to be really small. So, So we get back to Phoenix and we unload our truck and went back to the U-Haul place. The manager wasn't there. He's on vacation. So I hired some guys. They were supposed to get the truck unloaded in 5 hours. It took 12 hours because it rains in Phoenix. I don't know if you knew that, but it actually rains in Phoenix. Yeah, in the desert, rains there. And so it took us 12 hours. So we get done, and I take the guys inside because I want to bless them, pay them more for just spending the whole day with me and all of that. And so we shut the door, truck's still outside, loaded the last box into the house. There's a knock on the door, and we open the door, and there's this man standing there, and he says, hey, my name's Don, one of your neighbors here right across the street. Just wanted to come over here and meet you and, you know, introduce myself and, you know, find out what you're doing. Are you guys buying? Are you leasing? And we're like, no, we're leasing. You know, we're planting a church here, and we don't know where that campus is going to be, so we might move closer to it later on. So we're just leasing for now. And, you know, well, tell me about that church, you know. So I start telling them about the church, and it's a church just like this one, man. I mean, it's a church where we're okay with the presence of God. We're okay with just being free to worship and all of that. And so as I'm talking, I can see, like, the lights are just going off in his eyes. And he goes, man, I got to tell you, my family's across the street, and there's another family that lives across the street from us. And, man, we've tried some places, but, man, there was just something missing. And, man, what you're talking about sounds like something we want to be involved with. I told my wife, I said, we're not even knocking on somebody's door. They're knocking on my door right here. We've been here 2 minutes. And so Don and Jennifer, man, they've been hanging out, and we're there on day one, man. We're a part of this thing. So I'll get back to this. So I take this, finally get back to close out my account at U-Haul, right? Walk in the door. Haven't seen the guy in 6 weeks. Say, hey, man, do you remember my wife and I, crazy church planners, you know? And he's like, man, yeah. He goes, my wife and I have been talking about it, and she's not here right now, but she's on her way. But we really want to go out to dinner with you guys and find out how we can be a part of this church and make a difference in the Southeast Valley. And I'm like, is this even happening? It's like, this is like easy stuff, right? It's just coming together. And so basically from that time, I'm going to jump way ahead in the story. The church planning organization that, Pastor Jonathan was talking about asked us to try to build a team of 35 people so that we could launch with a, strong core team. And God has blessed us in the 5 months we've been there. We're still 3 months away from launch. Actually, today, 3 months from today is our launch. And as of right now, our team is almost at 70 people that have come together. It just coming from everywhere, every background. So God's blessing. And we're going to try to build a team of about 100. But God keeps saying to us, he keeps saying, don't remember the former things. Don't consider the things of, old. Behold, I'm going to do a new thing. And there's been words that have been spoken about how fast it was going to happen. And so I'll tell you this last little piece before I move forward a little bit here. And that is that the lady that messaged us on Facebook, she said, we're far from God. So we, for 5 months, man, we've just built a relationship because this is a non-judgmental zone right here. We're like Planet Fitness, if you know what that is, man. This is no judgment right here, you know, and because we all got our issues, you know. I don't belong anywhere near Planet Fitness, but I'm not going to judge. You know what I'm talking about, right? So judgment-free zone, no expectations, man. You just enter into relationship, man. You know, I'm good with just eating out if that's all you want to do. You don't, there's no progress. You don't need to make progress. Let's just hang out and see what God does. And so she messaged me on Facebook. Seemed like this is all about Facebook, you know. She messaged me on Facebook 4 days ago after 5 months. Church hasn't even started yet. 5 months that we've been just loving on her. And she messages me about 4 days ago on Facebook. And she says, I just can't fight it any longer. I gave my heart to Jesus today, and I'm ready to move forward. Isn't that awesome? Man. It's incredible to me. We were able to, a lot of last things here. By the way, when I get down to the close, I close like 9 times. I'm just saying, right? Not really. So last thing I say, Jeff, I'm so proud of my team because these guys have come together. And about 2 weeks ago, we took almost 40 people to a nonprofit called Feed My Starving Children. We packed 159 boxes of food with over 34,000 meals in them, enough to feed 94 kids for a year, and sent that to the Philippines and over into Asia. That all, but we never had a church service yet. We're not even coming together yet, but God allowed us to do that. So let me, you can tell I'm excited about that, man. Just get a little up about this. But let me just move on because I feel like God's got a word for the house today. God's not talking here when he says, I want you to forget about the things of the past and the things of old. He's not talking here about the failures of the past, although he's all about that too. And if you come to Jesus and you put your faith in him, man, love communion this morning. That is awesome stuff, because if you put your faith in Jesus Christ, literally all of the old stuff is done away with. No more sin in your past. No more mistakes in your past. You are washed clean, white as snow. And so, but God's not talking about that. He's saying, look, I want you to forget about the miracles of the past. Don't concentrate on the provision of the past or the open doors of the past. As awesome as all that was, I'm going to do a new thing. So one more time, tell somebody next to you, God is getting ready to do a new thing. All right. So in this process, I've been thinking a lot about the Holy Spirit. Anytime you see the phrase Holy Spirit in the Bible, it's referring to God in action. It's talking about what God is doing close up and personal, right, with us in this day. And so that starts in the very beginning in Genesis, and we'll go to that in a minute. But the first time you see the Holy Spirit, he's in action. He's hovering over the water. So we'll come back to that. But it had been prophesied in Joel, if you've read the little bitty prophet in the Old Testament called Joel, somebody called Joel, that it says in the last days, God says, I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. That was going to be a new thing. If you read the Old Testament and even the Gospels, you'll find out that God had strategically allowed his spirit to come upon some people throughout the Old Testament, but it was just one individual here, and then 100 years later, one over here, and maybe 500 years later, somebody over here. But he says, I'm going to do a new thing, and I'm going to pour out my spirit upon all flesh. He'd already done it the first time, but this time it's going to be incredible, because when God does something new, it's always better than what he did before. Have you come to realize that? You look in the Bible, when I fall off the stage, you look in the Bible and you find out that God says, look, I know this is not the way it's supposed to be, but the latter rain, the second rain, is going to be better than the first rain. That there was a first temple, but God said the second temple is going to be better than that. He said there was a first Adam, and that man became a living being, but there is a second Adam who is a life-giving spirit. When God does something new, it's better. It's more awesome. And so he gave the first covenant, the old covenant. That was a covenant of if you keep all the rules, then you'll be blessed in this life. But the second covenant says, I'm going to keep what you can't keep, and you're going to be blessed forever, not just this life, but in the life to come. Right? He says it's awesome to be born the first time, right, from your mama's womb. I mean, that's awesome, the natural birth. But there is a second birth that is even better than that. And I want you to experience something new, and God always makes it better. He says, I breathe. Adam, you remember the story where God creates Adam out of the dust of the ground, right? And he breathes into man's nostrils the breath of life. That is an awesome thing, that God would actually breathe life into us that first time. But isn't it interesting that in both the Hebrew of the Old Testament and the Greek of the New Testament, that both of those words for spirit literally mean breath or air or wind. I mean, you could actually translate that, the holy breath of God. And so when the Holy Spirit comes on us, you have the first breath where you've got life, you're walking around, right? But he says, I want to breathe into you something new, a new breath. And that's why I say, come on, Holy Spirit, holy breath of God, come on me in whatever way you want to come on me, because it's even better than the first time. Somebody said amen. So I'm thinking about all of this and the Holy Spirit and God in action and God doing something new. And I felt like that God spoke five things into my spirit for what he wants to do for this church family and for the individuals that are here for us and through us. So we're going to talk about that. I've been preaching. I don't know how long I've been preaching, but that's about 90% of it. We're getting ready to wrap it up here in just a hurry. You guys ready? Haven't blown your hair back yet too much, right? All right, so five things that I felt like God spoke into my spirit, both from Genesis 1 and then from Isaiah 43. So let's go to Genesis 1 real quick. Well, just the first few verses, right? Genesis 1, it's one of my favorite passages of Scripture. I really freaked a rabbi out one time. Went to visit a synagogue, and my dad was a theologian. But at one point, my dad had this course on Hebrew where you could learn to speak Hebrew by listening to it. And so I actually heard Genesis 1 in Hebrew, and so I thought, I'm just going to memorize that in Hebrew. So I went to visit the synagogue, and I got it behind the podium, and I noticed the scroll was open to Genesis 1. So this is awesome. I'm going to freak somebody out here. So I look at the scroll, and I act like I'm getting all spiritual. You know, and I just throw off Bara Elohim et Hashamayim ve et Ha'ad. I'm not speaking in tongues right there. Ve et Ha'ad. I start reading this, and the rabbi's like, "What do you have? This white boy can speak Hebrew." He's like, "No, white boy can memorize sounds is what he can do." So this is one of my favorites right here. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Think about what that must have been like, right? I've got this dream, man, when we get to heaven and we're you know, in God's presence forever, God can do anything, right? And God does everything better than we can do. And so all of the video technology, the LED screens, and even holographic stuff that's up on smoke and water and all that kind of stuff that we can do, God can do better than that. So I've got a dream that God, I'm going to be in heaven, I'm going to look to God, and I'm going to say, you know what, God, I want you to plant my spirit out in the middle of the black universe and show me a historical replay of the creation of everything. I want to be floating out in the blackness when all of a sudden things just appear out of nothing, right? I would love to be there. I'd love to be there when God just flips the light switch on and says, let there be light, right? Because that would be awesome. So this is what's happening. God creates the heavens and the earth, verse 2, and the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God, there it is, it's hovering over the face of the waters. And then God said, let there be light, and there was light. And so I felt like as I was reading that God spoke to me three things that were going to come out of that passage that God wants to do for somebody in this house and for this church, but not just for you, but also through you. So here's the three things. First of all, when God does something new, he brings something out of nothing. This is the creative aspect of God, the creative nature of God. He is capable of bringing something out of nothing. When there is no resource, when there is no strength, when there is no possibilities, God can bring something out of nothing. But that's not all that he's doing in this passage. The Bible also tells us that he is bringing order out of chaos. Can anybody use that in your life today for God to step into the chaos of your life and just bring order to it? He does that through the power of the Holy Spirit. But that's not the only thing he does. He also said, I'm going to bring light out of the darkness. Have you ever experienced what real darkness is? You get up in the middle of the night for whatever reason, and you walk past the bed, and your wife, so she's such a good wife, and you've been married to her for almost 24 years, and man, she does the laundry, and she does good work with the laundry. And she loves to leave that basket of clean clothes like right there at the foot of the bed, man. And you walk around the bed in the middle of the night in the darkness, and you trip and you fall on your face and you call on Jesus. Right? Because when there's darkness around you, you can't see where you're going. You don't know how to proceed. But God says, I'm going to speak light into your darkness so that you can see the path that you need to go. So this is what God is saying. I'm going to do this for you. I'm going to bring something out of nothing, order out of chaos, light out of the darkness. And I'm going to do it for you, but I'm also going to do it through you. I'm going to come back to that. Now let me go back to Isaiah 43. Are you ready for this? He says, behold, I will do a new thing. Now it shall spring forth. Shall you not know it? Here's the other two things I felt like he said he was going to do. He says, I will make a road in the wilderness. This is a place where there is no direction. There is no pathway. I don't know where to go. I don't know the step to take. I don't know the decisions that I need to be making in this season of my life. He says, I'm going to make a road right there in the wilderness, and I'm going to give you rivers in the middle of the desert. Rivers in the middle of the desert. If you've ever been in the desert, if you want to come to Phoenix from June until August and into September, you're going to find out what 118 degrees feels like. But what's nice about it is it's dry. I don't care how dry it is. If it's 118 degrees, you're cooking right there, right? But he says, you know what? It doesn't matter. In the middle of the desert, I'm going to put a river there. It's going to be a river that brings provision. Everywhere there's water, there's life, right? So I'm going to bring life. I'm going to put something there that's not there naturally, going to be by my power. And what this says to me is, look, I'm going to bring my presence into your life in such a way that there is an empowering and there is a refreshing. And so that brings me to the words of Jesus in John 7, where it says this. This is Jesus. He's standing. It's the last day, the great day of the feast. And Jesus stands and cries out saying, if anybody thirsts, let him come to me and drink it in. I mean, just drink everything. Drink it in. He who believes in me, as the scripture has said, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water. Man, I'm thinking of rivers right in the middle of the desert. I've known people, and I've been in this position myself, where I have felt dry. I have felt far from God. It's like everything around me had sucked every bit of moisture out of my life. There was no life there. And then all of a sudden, through the power of the Holy Spirit, rivers of living water can come right out of the middle of something that was dry. He says, let me explain to you what I'm talking about. This he spoke concerning the Spirit whom those believing on him would receive. Book of Acts actually says it's about times of refreshing that comes from the presence of God. Have you ever been so dry and so hot that when you take a drink out of that nice bottle of tap water that they call purified water that they got out of a tap somewhere? Have you ever taken that drink and just felt the coolness come down here and then just spread out? Man, that is what I'm talking about. Times of refreshing that God is going to do through the power of his Spirit. So five things for somebody, but also through somebody, because the Bible says this, we are co-laborers with him. So I want you to watch this. Not only are we going to do some things that are good, we're going to do some great things. In fact, Jesus says it this way, John 14 and verse 12, he says, most assuredly, I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, will he do also. We're talking about missions. We're talking about taking a step of faith. We're talking about doing some incredible things, right, in your life, for your church family, what we're doing. So he says, he who believes in me, the work that I do, he will do also. That was a reference to his interns. That's a reference to his disciples in their life with him before he poured his Spirit out. Jesus authorized them to go out and to heal the sick, to cleanse the leper, to raise the dead, and they did that, and they came back, man, talking about how awesome they were for what they had done. Wow, look at this. He says, you believe in me, you can do the works that I do right now, even before the outpouring of the Spirit. But then he says, and greater works than these will you do because I go to my Father. Now, what is that talking about? He said, you're going to do greater things, but you're going to do it because Jesus is leaving. Why is that important? Now, remember this in John 7, down here at verse 39, he's saying, but this he spoke concerning the Spirit whom those believing in him would receive, for the Holy Spirit had not yet been given because Jesus had not yet been glorified. So there was something about Jesus being glorified and ascending up back into heaven that was going to release something into our lives that was going to help us to do even greater things than Jesus had done in his earthly ministry. So now we come to Acts chapter 2, where the Holy Spirit has already been poured out, and Peter is standing up. This is Peter, foot in the mouth Peter. Peter, the one who's always saying something he shouldn't say, getting in trouble. The man who denied Jesus three times, so he should be out, right? Three strikes and you're out. But here he is, faith in Jesus on the day of Pentecost, standing up, preaching the word, and he gets it. He understands why we're going to do greater things than Jesus did while he was on the earth. He says, this Jesus God has raised up, of which we are all witnesses. Therefore, being by the right hand of God and having received from the Father the promise of the Holy Spirit, he has poured out this which you now see and hear. Because Jesus has ascended to the Father, you and I now have access to the Holy Spirit. He said, I'm going to pour it out on all flesh. So if you're in this house today and you need God to do something for you, it's as easy as this. Put your faith in him and breathe in. Just breathe in the breath of God, the Holy Spirit. It's not something you have to work for. It's not something you have to plead for. You don't have to beg for it. In fact, Jesus himself said, man, your Father in heaven is better than any father on earth, and he will give the Holy Spirit to them that ask him. So let me ask you this question. I'm shutting up right now. Let me ask you this question. Is there anybody in the house that needs God to do something out of nothing? Anybody in the house, you need God to just bring some order out of the chaos. You need God to speak some light into the darkness of your life, right? Anybody here need a road in the middle of the wilderness, just direction? Somebody need that river right in the middle of that desert, right? I don't know about you guys, but I feel like God said he's going to do this for us. But as we go do the works of God, we're called in missions, right? We give and we also go. And so as we're going, and whether that's going to your family right here in town, or whether that's, you know, going across the street to a stranger, to a businessman, whether it's going, you know, to another city to plant a church, or whether it's going around the world, I feel like that God spoke to me and said that he was going to let his people step into a season of co-laboring with him, where we're not just experiencing things in our own life. We're literally going to be able to bring something out of nothing as we go. We're going to be able to bring order out of chaos as we go, because we're operating in the power of the Holy Spirit, that we are going to be able to speak light into the darkness. Anybody want to do that? Anybody want to kind of get together with God and just share in that work and bring that hope to somebody? Man, that's me too. Would you stand with me? You guys doing all right? Did I go too long? Am I right? All right. Wow. Here's what I want to do. I want to just pray a couple of things. First of all, I want to pray for those people today that you just feel like, man, I identify with one of those five things. I need God to do that in my life. So if you would, just for a moment, would you just close your eyes just right where you're at? We're just going to get authentic before God for a second. If one of those things you identify with, you need God to just bring something out of nothing today, order out of chaos, light out of darkness, a river in the desert, a road right in the middle of the wilderness, would you just slip a hand up and say, yeah, that's me. I need that today. Awesome. God's getting ready to do this, man. This is not something you put your hands down. This is not something that I can do. This is only the Holy Spirit. So just with your eyes closed, they're going to begin to play this. I want us just to take this to him, because it's as simple as this. We're not going to beg. We're just going to speak this, that what God has promised that he will do. Hallelujah. Right now, Father, in the name of Jesus, you saw the step of faith that they took by lifting their hand. You saw that. You saw every hand that went up in the life it represents, God, and you know what's going on. You know the details of their life. You know the struggle that they're going through. You know that obstacle that they seem to be facing, God. But right now, we declare that you are greater. that you are greater, that you have got an incredible plan and a purpose for their life, and you are literally removing obstacles out of the way right now. We speak that in the name of Jesus. I speak into the life of every person here right now that literally is without resource, that literally has found a place where they feel, when they talk about it, they're like, I've got nothing. I've got no answers. I've got no hope here. I've got no way to accomplish this. And God is stepping into your life right now and saying, I can bring something out of nothing. He's doing that for you right now in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Some of you are standing here right now, and man, when you go home today, you just analyze your life, and you analyze your family, you analyze your work situation. Everything seems chaotic, and it's hard to find peace in the middle of that chaos. And I just speak order right now, that God is bringing order into this, and you're going to begin to see pieces that, like a puzzle that's been scattered all over the place. You're gonna begin to see pieces come together, and you're gonna realize that what looked random before was in the mind of God, the plan of God for you, and it's going to come together and form something beautiful in your life. That's happening right now in the name of Jesus. And for those of you that have been wandering around in darkness, man, you just don't know where to go, man. You're not sure what to do. God is speaking light to you right now. Let there be light. Let there be light. Hallelujah. God, for those looking for direction, God, trying to make a decision, it's a big decision. But God, you can make a road right where there is no road. You're able to blow the obstacles out of the way. You're able to bring up the valleys and smooth out the mountains. You're able to create the perfect environment for a pathway to your purpose for their life. I speak that right now in the name of Jesus. And for those that are in this house right now, you know what, just with your eyes closed, if you say, you know what I need is a refreshing in this dry place I call my soul. If that's you, would you just lift both hands to heaven right now? Just both hands. Just like a child saying, Daddy, pick me up. Would you do that? Say, I need this refreshing right now. Hallelujah. Just leave your hands up for a moment. Father, right now, Holy Spirit, come upon every one of us. Breathe into us, I pray right now. Breathe the holy breath of God into every heart that is in this place that's saying, I'm dry in here and I want rivers. I want rivers of living water. Would you just do that even symbolically? Just kind of breathe in. That's symbolizing the presence of God. He's pouring into your life right now. He is here right now. Rivers in the middle of the wilderness right now. Rivers in the middle of that desert in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, Holy Spirit, come. We ask you like you said. You said if we ask, you give it. So we're asking, God, let the Holy Spirit fall right now on every person. Hallelujah. Let rivers begin to flow. Rivers, rivers in the dry places, God. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 One last prayer I want to pray. Just keep drinking in of the Spirit if that's where you're at, man. Just keep on drinking in. But I want to pray one more prayer because I saw the hands of people that went up and said, I want to partner with God. I feel like I'm agreeing with that word this morning that God is literally wanting to do something through my life. He's wanting to do something miraculous in my life. He wants me to co-labor with Him in those five things. And so I want to be a part of that. So I want to pray for you right now. Still eyes closed if you would. In the name of Jesus, Father, thank you, Lord, for that spark of faith, God, that's been ignited in the hearts of people this morning. And they realize, God, that it's not just you doing the work, but you're working through us, that you're literally empowering us through your Spirit to do something amazing. And so I call forth that creative nature of God upon the people of God, that through the power of the Holy Spirit, your people would become creative in a way that can bring something out of nothing, that you would bring new ideas and new imaginations and new thoughts, things that no one else has ever done before or thought of, that the creative nature of God would be upon His people in Jesus' name. I pray you'd give somebody in this house vision so that they can see in the middle of chaos how things can come back into divine alignment with the word and the purpose of God. Let it be done in Jesus' name. That someone here in this house would feel the power of the Spirit in their life so that they can go into the dark areas of their life, into neighborhoods, into businesses, into families, and begin to speak light and life into them in Jesus' name. I pray, God, that as we go, you would help us to show other people the road, the path in the middle of the wilderness. Help us to show them you because you are the way. I pray you just like ignite a fire in a bunch of evangelists through here that just go out and say, Jesus is the way. Man, I feel this word for somebody here. This is what Paul talks about in 2 Corinthians chapter 5. He says, God reconciled all things to himself. And what that means is that God has removed all barriers between he and man, that there is no barrier, there's no judgment, there's no law, there's nothing that is standing between you and God. And then Paul says, now let's take on the task of telling people to be reconciled to God. So he removed the barriers. Now we have the awesome privilege of stepping out and saying, come on, come to God, come to him, because there's nothing standing between you, no judgment. So we release that upon somebody today. You've always wondered how you could bring people to faith in Jesus, and God is just getting ready to make it easy for you. A road in the wilderness. And God, I pray that through this people, that you would just bring the Holy Spirit to this city and to the communities around here, God. Much like Peter and John when they went to Samaria and all these believers were following you. And they went into this place and they laid hands on people and said, let the Holy Spirit fall, and the Holy Spirit fell. I pray you would let that anointing rest upon some people in this house, that they could just bring the presence of God into every place that they go. And I thank you, because I know testimonies of this are going to be many. Many testimonies of what's going to happen because they are stepping into that anointing today. I thank you for it, Father, in Jesus' name. And everybody that just receives that today, would you just say amen? Amen. God bless you guys.
Hallelujah. You may be seated. Amen. We're going to invite, we're going to have some of our leaders help us bring some stools. We're going to invite our friends to come and to just sit right here, because we're going to minister over them. I believe in coming into agreement with God's will. Amen. God says something, no man can oppose it. We're coming into agreement with the will of God, and these folks are stepping out into faith to go into Phoenix, and we're partnering with them. Amen. We're a young baby church in San Francisco, but it's all right to partner with a bigger vision than our own. Amen. We're going to prophesy over them. We're going to lay hands on them. We're going to send them out with a great offering. It's going to be awesome. Don't feel pressured by us by any means. Again, there's several guests here today. It's not one of those weird things where don't be pressured for anything. If the Lord speaks to you, however, I want you to be obedient to that. Whatever it is you want to sow into this ministry, that's awesome. Everything, we don't take any cut of this. Everything that we give towards this church plant, all of it goes to their church plant. And there's an organization that's going to match it, so it just doubles up. It's amazing. My wife and I, we already wrote a check earlier, put it in the red box, and that we'll be doing that in a moment here. But why don't you guys come and grab these chairs? Invite John and Nita to come. Pastor Marquise, if you're available. I know you're multitasking this morning. Pastor Keys, Pastor Elena. Rachel, would you join us? Lauren, come on up. I heard you prophesy the other day. Why don't you come and join us? If you guys haven't met Steph and Lauren from South Africa, what a gift. A gift from God to us this summer. And to make sure you greet them and you invite them out to lunch. They got to see San Francisco. They got to get to meet our city. Amen. We're going to lay hands on them and prophesy. Is that cool? Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Well, it says that he's rested his hand upon you, that he selected you. Like there was a drawing board and like a draft where different individuals are drafted. God selected you to go and to bear much fruit in a place that is indeed a wilderness. But God is saying that there is an oasis of the Spirit of God that is coming forth in Phoenix and even in the broader areas there, the suburbs. God's going to come, and not only have you already seen the divine appointments of the Lord, different individuals connecting to you. There's been a cry in the land. There's been a cry in the land asking, God, are you there? And God says that he's sending you to be those that would be bearers of the good news, those that would bring indeed refreshing water to the parched mouth. He's going to anoint you to sing a song of the Lord. There is a river whose streams, they make glad the city of our God. God says that there's going to be an oasis. There's going to be like a geyser that will come forth and erupt from within you. And you're going to bring refreshing to many lives around you there. And God says that he's given you a blank check to believe for even things that are beyond the natural. There's a favor upon you. He's going to make a way even where there seems to be no way. A blank check, a favor of God to believe for the impossible, not to settle for that which is conventional, even those things that we were trained with. God says that he's going to supersede and exceed even those things that you've conceived in your mind. He's going to surprise you and to position yourself, for there's great rain coming. There's great rain coming. The cisterns are going to be filled. The wells are going to be watered once again, and they're going to be filled. For God has purposed to pour out his spirit upon that region. And you're going to have influence not only in one specific location, but in time. God is going to broaden your horizons. He's going to broaden your influence. He's going to enlarge your influence. And you're going to go here and there and everywhere. And you're going to speak the word of God. You're going to lay hands on the sick. They will recover. The demon-possessed, those who are oppressed by the evil one, they're going to be set free. For the hand of God is upon you, says the Lord. Servant of God, maidservant of God, the hand of the Lord rests upon you.
As you brought a word about the Holy Spirit today, the same word would come back again to you and your family here. And even in worship today, the Lord began to speak to me about in the scripture where Jesus just even blew his breath on the disciples and said, that to receive the Holy Spirit. And yet that was just a portion, for a greater portion fell out on the day of Pentecost. And I just see increase and escalation, and that you should never be satisfied with just one level, because God would say, have a vision for an increase. And he began to speak to me even of the story of Esther, and even as Mordecai just really represents the Holy Spirit in that story. But he spoke to me the scripture from Ecclesiastes, that there is a time and a purpose for everything under heaven. And this would be the time, and even as in the book of Esther, where we see that it was time for Esther to be there. But Mordecai came every day as she was in her preparation time for 12 months, 6 months with one incense and 6 months with another. I just sense that you have been through seasons of just preparation, and that the Holy Spirit has been checking on things every day, because there's a time and a purpose for that which God would have. And I just believe that this is it. And even at the end of the, I saw the scripture at the end of the book of Esther, where it says about Mordecai, because don't forget, there's the season of preparation, but then as time would go, it would even escalate that portion of the Holy Spirit, and that he would come, and that even at the very end of the book of Esther, it says of Mordecai, of the Holy Spirit, that he sought the wealth of his people, and that he spoke peace to the people, to his people. And that would even be that which you would bring to the city of Phoenix, that you would be those who would seek out the prosperity, body, soul, and spirit of the people in that place, and that you would be those who would begin to bring just a word of peace. A word of peace would come. Lord, bless them, I pray. Let your Holy Spirit just be increased and multiplied. Thank you, Lord.
Yes, Father, thank you for the gift of vulnerability, Lord, and honesty that's on their life, Lord, just to break themselves open, Lord, before so many people, Lord. God, their hearts are so open to receive, Lord, the broken, Father, the lost, Lord, even those with pride, Lord. I just sense people are going to come to you, then they've got pride in their heart, but God is just saying the gentleness and the goodness of the Lord is going to bring them to repentance. And Father, we thank you that you have brought this family, Lord, to such a place of humility, Lord, such a place, Lord, of desperate hunger for your presence. I just see Moses that wrestles with God and says, I will not go if your spirit does not go with us. Lord, who will you send? Father, and I thank you, Lord, that as Moses separated himself from the camp, Lord, that the people watched him go. And Father, as that cloud descended upon that camp, the people fell to their knees and they worshipped. And Father, I thank you for this family that as they go, Lord, before them, just like Psalm 16 says, I held the Lord before me always and I will not be moved. And so, Father, we thank you that as they go, Lord, they will never focus, Lord, on the nitty-gritty and the detail, Lord, of trying to bring the people in, but their first priority will be seeking the presence of God in their most inner room, Lord. And as they do that, Lord, your presence goes with you. And I just see God promising you a fire by night and a cloud by day. God, and wherever that fire goes, Lord, your presence will go, Lord. I thank you. I just anoint their hands, God, just for the fire of God to come upon them, Lord. Just that the fire will burn away everything, Lord, that is not from you. And the fire has gone ahead of you. And that is why the people are coming, because they experience the fire. They experience the presence of God over you. In Jesus' name.
Lord, we speak life. We speak blessings on this ministry, God. We thank you for those that have already come, God. We pray, Lord, as they get ready in the next few months, Lord, to continue not just to encourage them from the inside out, God, that these leaders, Lord, from all over, Lord, every ethnic group, Lord, a heart of compassion, God, a church of diversity, Lord, that the anointing that's on John John's life and the mentorship that's happening, God, that it will flow all the way to Arizona, God. That the team would have a heart for all people, God, all nations, God. That you will open doors of favor. Send leaders, God, of different ethnic groups, God. Encourage them, Lord, as they encounter you, Jesus. That they will all come together. As you told Peter, Lord, do you love his sheep? Do you love them? I pray that these leaders would love the sheep, God. There will be no judgment, no discomfort, God. There will be a peace and a compassion and a love for all, God. And it will preach the gospel, reconciling nations together for your glory, God. Expand the kingdom in Arizona, God. Open the door of favor with many other churches, God. Many other leaders, other pastors, other ministries, God. Let life-giving churches come to his aid, God. Let them build a community, Lord, of leaders and pastors to seek the well-being of the city, God. Let them build the walls like Nehemiah, God. Let them reestablish worship and the word in that city, God. We thank you, Lord, for this pastor and his family, Lord. We speak life and blessings, Lord, on each one of them, Lord. And each of the 70, God, encourage them, Lord. Let them not get weary in well-doing, for in due time they will reap, God, your reward.
And God says that even in every season, as he's already begun, he will bring people to lift your hands. He will bring the people that will support you in every season. Even when people come and when they go, God will continue to replenish his house. And God will continue to send you the leaders that you need. And God says that he's putting within you a warring spirit, that you will continue to war, and you will go in and you will speak the word of the Lord. And where there has been famine, you will speak the word of the Lord. And God will give you boldness, and he will allow you to go in. And as you begin to go in, God will put a song within your heart. Robin, God will put a song within your heart and will be a song of victory. Even as Deborah sung a song after the victory, God gives within both of you the ability to look into a situation and see what is going on, to find wisdom to be able to fight the battle. And then after the battle is won, there will be a song of victory that will go forth, and the word of the Lord will go, and your house will continue to double. I see a double portion continuing, and your continued growth continued, even in seasons where it seems nothing is happening. There will be a warring spirit that will stand up, and as you stand up, you'll fight the battle, and the Lord will go before you. You will not be afraid, but you will stand forward encouraged, and you will walk forward, and you'll see the hand of the Lord, because he's with you. And a double portion will come every single time, and he'll bring new strength and new hope. And you're not to fear in the seasons where it feels like it's dark, because God's about to give you the battle plan, because he has given you that warring spirit, and a victory song will continue to come in the name of the Lord.
just want to echo what Lauren said. The Lord spoke the same thing to me, that he was going to be the cloud by day and the fire by night for you. You know, and the cloud was the cover from the beating sun during the day. And he's going to come and he's going to cover you guys from just the things that would come and try to wear you down, that would come over time. And he's going to be the fire by night. Lord, that even in the midst of the darkness, that there will be a light that will guide your way forward. There will be a light, Lord, just pointing them in the direction and the next steps that they're supposed to take. And I also just felt that the Lord would come to just confirm that he is placing something very precious in your care, because he does trust you, and because you guys are faithful. You are faithful, that you do love his sheep, Lord. And so he just wants to come, and he's saying, I am well pleased with you, and I'm going to give you great things, and there's more to come, and it's going to blow your mind, and it's going to be even greater than what you could imagine, because you are faithful. And so just keep doing what you're doing, and you will just be blown away by what he's going to do in you, because of your love for his people, for his sheep. Thank you, Jesus, for them.
Had a very simple vision of why God is sending you there. I think God is sending anyone anywhere to save people and to restore them and to set them on the path of relationship with Jesus. But our nation is in turmoil, and it's in turmoil in many different ways. Arizona is in turmoil. In many different ways, a different kind of turmoil than maybe what we have in California. And I think that God is going to make you a peacemaker there. There are groups that are discontented. There are groups that are in enmity with each other. And I think you're going to be a peacemaker. And it's a high call. It's not an easy call. It's a high call. And it helps to come from the throne room when you're a peacemaker, because you have the mind of God, not the mind of man, because the mind of man changes, it fluctuates, it's selfish. But when you're a peacemaker, you have the heart of God. And I just really sense that this family will be a peacemaking family.
Listen, this wasn't your idea in the first place. God says this was his idea. You didn't come up with this grandioso plan. You didn't concoct this in your own minds, though the enemy at times would war with your mind to say, yeah, you're asking for God's blessing, but this originated in you. God says that that's a lie from the enemy. God is the one who places dreams in your heart. He's the one that has quickened even this desire in this season to step out of the boat. This was not your idea. This is not your idea. This was God's idea, and you've simply come into alignment with his will, and this is the time. He's fashioned you, he's groomed you, he's positioned you, and he's launching you now in this season. For this is the will of God, and this is the timing of God, says the Lord. So, Father, we stand as even City Life Church, let's stand to our feet, church. We stand as a body of believers here in San Francisco and in the Bay Area. We're not just wishing them good luck in this new adventure, but, Father, we partner with them. Prophetically, we partner with them, and we say, let your kingdom come. Let your will be done on earth in Phoenix, Arizona, just as it is in heaven. And Father, today we speak the word of faith. We speak a word of encouragement. Father, we declare the favor of God upon them. Your word says in Psalms 5:12 that, Lord, you bless the righteous and you cover them with the shield of favor. Lord, we speak forth the favor of God upon them, upon this household, upon this home, upon Christiana, Father God, upon their grandbaby. Father, we thank you, Lord, that you call them to be the head and not the tail, above and not beneath. Father, we declare that you will make a way even where there seems to be no way. So, Father, we come into agreement with your will. We say yes, God. We say yes to your purposes. We say yes to Encounter Church coming to Phoenix, Arizona. Father, we pray that you would cover them, that you would meet their every needs, that you would surprise them, that you would bless them, that you would encamp about them. Lord, that you would guard them and keep them in your perfect will. We bless them now in the mighty name of Jesus. And all of God's people said, amen. Come on, somebody. Let's give the Lord some praise. Amen. You guys are awesome. Stuck around for a few minutes longer. You're resilient. Hey, listen, if you're writing checks today, write it to City Life, and everything that we receive, we'll pass it on to them. We'll keep the number on the screen for those of you who want to text the gifts in. Let's be generous. Amen. Hey, don't forget, Wednesday night, we'll be right up in here again, hanging out with the church family, food, fellowship, hangout. Be blessed. Have a great week. We'll see you again next time. God bless you.